people. But this is refreshing. Nice work. So thank you, Paul, for setting the bar so unbelievably high with those slides. That was done. Can we give it up for Paul? Paul in here all day. MCM, Tom Perry, whatever you want to call it. Oh, you started the clock, you bastard. So anyway, I'm going to run through this quickly, otherwise Paul will beat you with an iron stick. I want to talk about me for a second. I do brand help companies figure out how to do stuff I'm going to talk about, but my real passion, as Paul has alluded to, is travel, and I have this travel show where I'm fortunate enough to go around the world and make little documentaries about the people and places, and most importantly, the food that I discover along the way. So that's kind of a passion of mine. But I want to spend the next 19 minutes talking about how you, as organizations, brands, companies, individuals, can stand out, can lift yourself above the increasing noise of the marketplace, no matter where you are in the world. It's not easy. So I want to do that by sharing a couple of ideas and examples I've seen that have frankly just made me smile, and I hope will inspire you as well. And these are going to be examples from huge companies that you're all very familiar with, and a couple from companies that I know none of you have ever heard of. And that's okay. Size and geography really don't matter. It's the stories behind them. As far as I'm concerned, in this day and age, you can no longer just build a product or service and put it out there and go, why isn't anybody using it? The product must be bad. It doesn't work like that anymore. You cannot just put it out there and expect people to use it. You have to work a lot harder. You have to invest in your relationship with the customers. So I want to share a few things that I've seen companies do to move in that direction. And the first one is to create a sense of emotion. Don't worry, I'm not getting all hippie on you. This is actually based on some science I didn't make up for this talk. I'm a huge fan, I'm obsessed with the psychology of loyalty. Why do we choose brand A over brand B? What's happening? And fundamentally, if you want somebody to come back to you and buy your product time and time again, you have to create a sense of an emotional relationship. They have to connect with you on an emotional level. Loyalty is purely based on the emotional side of the brain, not on the rational, logical side of the brain. I am loyal to my wife, not because of the rational and logical side of my brain, believe me. For those of you that are not my wife, you know what I'm talking about. And this sense, I'm a dead man. This sense from the consumer of, I get it, I feel it, I know what you're doing. When I use your product, I feel something. I feel satisfied. I feel, you know, the Apple people in the room know exactly what I'm talking about. I have to feel something, a sense of ease, a sense of relief. This is from Mad Men, which is basically like pouring to marketing people like me. And I love this quote because it really nails home the importance of creating that sense of emotion when somebody uses your product. And there is actual science behind this. There is a Canadian neuroscientist called Dr. Donald King, whose work I'm doing a massive disservice by kind of simplifying like this. And he basically concluded that when we want someone to actually do something, emotion is far more powerful than reason. Why? Reason will lead to conclusion. 1 + 1 = 2, the specifications of this product fulfill my needs. But if we want someone to actually walk into the shop, pick up the phone, click purchase, we have to appeal to the emotional side of their brain because that is what drives action. And we overlook this so frequently. We're going to do this. We're going to do it. Got to do this all the time, but it's important. I'll ask you a question. What brand do you love? What product, service do you use every single day? What product or brand, doesn't really matter, could you not live without? My shout out to you. Don't be
Google.
Microsoft. You know, I'm a huge fan of Bill Gates. I really am. I'm going to say that right now. I did this once and somebody just said, beer. Actually, I heard someone in here. Anyway, my side code. Those of you that know me well know I have a borderline sociopathic obsession with Diet Coke. If I go into a bar or a restaurant and order a Diet Coke, and then, oh, is Pepsi okay? It's like they spit on my grandmother. No, it's not okay. In fact, I get really upset. And the logical part of my brain is like, dude, it's the same thing. It's brown water in a tin can that's slowly killing you. It doesn't really matter. But the emotional side of my brain is like, let's burn this place to the ground. It's like, so if I didn't have that kind of passionate response about something as awful as a can of soda, then people can have that same emotional response to what you do. No industry is immune to this. And a great way to create that sense of emotion is to create a sense of individuality. Treat your customers as people because, breaking news, they actually are. And they like being treated as human beings. And we tend to overthink this and go, oh, it's a big CRM project. It's really not. Small things are so, so powerful when we're talking about relationships here. There is a hotel in New York City that I first went to, oh my goodness, 2007. Small boutique hotel, not a chain, around the Times Square area. And you know when you go to a hotel and you check in, you have to fill in a piece of paper that's saying your first name, last name, email address, all that stuff. Well, this one said at the bottom of it, oh, what are your favorite snacks? Okay, weird, whatever. Blah, 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 Diet Coke, obviously. And then they took that piece of paper away, we completed the transaction. When I got to my room, there was a basket full of my favorite snacks, a handwritten note from the manager, and a fridge full of Diet Coke. I'm never staying in another hotel again. This is the greatest hotel in the world. Now, it's a cheap psychological trick to surround somebody in a hotel room with things that remind them of home. It was pioneered by the Mandarin Oriental group decades ago. But now I have an emotional connection because I'm happy. There are things that I'm familiar with in an otherwise unfamiliar scenario. That's not what they did right. That's easy. Every time I go back to that hotel, 6 weeks, 6 months later, I don't have to talk to anybody anymore. They've got those kiosk things. Go up to my room, basket full of snacks, handwritten note, fridge full of Diet Coke. They remember. So they're thinking about the relationship, not the transaction. Now, it sounds simple, but it's like me coming up to you and going, hey, my name is Alex. Ha, good to meet you. And then I come over here and have a conversation, and then 30 seconds later, come back and go, hey, I'm Alex. And you're like, dude, we just met. You're kind of a dick for not remembering that. We would never do it to another human being. Why on earth would we ever do it to our customers who are actually paying us? So optimizing the transaction, we're all really good at. We've got technology to help us squeeze every penny out of every link. But the businesses that are winning in 2016 are the ones that are taking the time to invest in the relationship. They're sacrificing the 10-euro Wi-Fi fee, giving it to us for free, knowing that we're going to come back time and time again, and that investment of 10 euros is going to pay off 10 times over the life of the relationship. And as we continue that relationship, we get all this wonderful data that we can use to create these moments of delight, which are so powerful. And I travel a lot. I travel with Virgin, not because I used to work for their parent company. I just do. So I have a gold card then, but I'm usually flying in the cheap seats, not the pointy end of the airplane. So I earn that thing the hard way, my gold card. And no matter where I'm sitting in the airplane, usually seat 72B, middle seat, next to the screening kid, invariably someone from the in-flight crew will come back and go, hey, Alex, it's good to see you again, and hand me a glass of champagne. Alex! Not C-72B, not frequent flight 969893, Alex, because that's my name and we're having a human-to-human moment. I don't even like champagne, I'm going to drink that shit, because I know exactly all the things that have to happen to make that little moment take place. Somebody in the in-flight team was given a piece of information and they could have thrown it in the bin, but they had the processing culture in place to go, he flies a lot with us, even though he's in the crappy part of the airplane. Let's go and say thank you. So powerful. Everybody knows what that is? Thermostat, right? Thermostat. Created by Tony Fadell, father of the iPod. And when he left Apple as a billionaire, he could have done anything. He could have gone into any industry. But he's like, you know what would be fun? Thermostats. That sounds like a hoot. Now, thermostats are, they're wider beige boxes that sit on your wall, keep your house too hot in the summer, too cold in the winter. But he's like, let's re-envision this entire thing. Not just the physical manifestation, but the process. So it learns your behaviors. When you go, obviously you control it by your smartphone, because what can't you control from your smartphone? You look at your patterns when you leave the house, where 10% of your life, you know, saves you money as a result. But he also made the thermostat itself so beautiful that he just wanted to go up and lick it. I mean, look at that thing. So now people are saying, why don't you come over to my house and look at my thermostat? No one has ever said that. So no industry is immune for this. I'll give you an example. Like, so Arthur C. Clarke, who was a British science fiction author, said, any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. Translation, it doesn't matter how it works as long as it works. The first time I showed my father Uber, I was like, oh, look at him. And he's like, oh, look, the little cars are moving. And I was like, yeah, here comes ours. He didn't care how it worked, the politics behind it, the mechanics behind it. All he knew is that I pressed a button on my phone and a freaking car appeared. The mechanics, the backstory, doesn't matter how it works to the end user. It's about the packaging, not the physical packaging, and the storytelling. And it's difficult when we're in our own business in the day-to-day to step out, take off the lab coat, and experience it through the eyes of the customer. And are we delivering that magic? So you guys are in Bulgaria, which is a very, very exciting country, a very exciting time as well. And inevitably, once you've reached a certain level of domestic success, you're going to want to go international. And that's awesome. And the temptation is to take what you've done and cut and paste it into different geographies. And I'm hesitant about that. I just don't think it works that well. I mean, you're going to have someone from GE later who can tell me if the story is bullshit. But I'm going to tell you anyway, because I kind of like it. So in the olden days, like 30 years ago, GE used to have one strategy globally. And as they grew and they had more offices in more countries, they realized that's not how people work. We are not a homogenous collection of people around the world. So now they have 160 strategies for 160 countries. Even if it's not entirely accurate, you get my point. We are a world of people with different ideas and cultures and concepts and processes, and we have to adapt. FedEx, I'm completely obsessed with this. If they tried to apply what they did in the US to Venice, you can't drive a semi-truck down a canal. I mean, it would be pretty funny to watch, but. So they have FedEx canal boats in Venice. They have the tuk-tuks in Thailand, they've got some, the trains, so they make sure that they can deliver the promise irrespective of where they are in the world. So they adapt. Sensible brands adapt to the environment in which they're doing business, and so you'll have to as well. And there's this awful, awful word, glocalization, which makes me want to throw up. But it's like, it's the portmanteau of globalization and localization. Very clever. I bet that came from The Economist. Anyway, McDonald's is a great example of that. I love McDonald's. Not so much for the food. Actually, you know what? Big Macs are awesome. I don't really care what anybody thinks. But they've been able to find this balance of consistent brand application, yet deferential menu creation and retail experience to wherever they are in the world. And it's really pretty magical. So you go into a McDonald's anywhere in the world and it is instantly familiar, and that's great. So you can go in there and the ordering process is the same. You'll always be able to get a Big Mac, a quarter pounder, and a McMuffin. But depending on where you are in the world, you'll also be able to get, so in India, where the vast majority of people don't eat beef for religious reasons, you don't have the Big Mac. You have the Maharaja Mac, which is basically chicken instead of beef. You have the Bulgogi burger in Korea, and the McVeggie in the Philippines, alongside all of these international favorites. And of course, they fit the brand. But if they tried to go into India with Big Macs, and that's it, they would last a week. I was just in Hong Kong, and they had the black burger, which I tried. And the stuff on the bottom is mashed potato. Of course it is. Anyway, that wasn't very good. Now, they managed to do this across countries as well with their kind of brand ambassador. So Ronald McDonald, the creepy clown, the French McDonald's, the people in France, McDonald's in France said, look, the kids are just kind of freaked out by Ronald. It's just not working. And so McDonald's Global HQ had the sense and pragmatism to say, look, McDonald's France, you guys know your audience better than we would. Why, do what you think is best for your audience. So in France, McDonald's kids, they have Asterix and Obelix who have replaced Creepy McClown Face as the global ambassador, the national ambassador for McDonald's. So having the bravery as global kind of brand owners to defer to the people on the ground in other countries and just say, of course you know your audience better. Do what you think. You know our brand values. Do what makes sense on the ground. That's brave, and it's not always easy to let go. And McDonald's have done that across 34,000 stores in nearly 120 countries and across 1.7 million staff. So it scales almost exponentially if you put the processes in place. But it doesn't always work brilliantly. So Virgin, God, this is depressing to see this. I was part of the team that founded Virgin America. I don't want to talk about it. I'm still in my, they just got bought by Alaska Airlines, so I'm having a little bit of a hard time dealing with that. It's like breaking up with your wife. Maybe even worse than that, I don't know. Anyway, they have three main airlines, Virgin America, Virgin Atlantic, Virgin Australia. They look very similar in terms of graphic representation. That's not a brand, it's a logo. The livery, the paint scheme, very similar. And the inside of the airplane, you know, very similar. They go for a very specific ethos. So you have people, I mean, they're very, you know, Virgin Atlantic is heavily international between the, you know, across the transatlantic. Virgin America is primarily domestically in the U.S. And Virgin Australia, obviously, originates out of Australia. So, but the problem is, and again, they all look very similar on the airplanes. You have people saying, I'm flying on Virgin Airlines. And we being the snob jerks at each individual airline, like, you're so stupid, there's no Virgin Airlines, come on, dummy. But the customer had set the expectation that because we all had the same logo, and ostensibly all had the same name, that we were one organization. And that is a fair assumption to make. When practically speaking, they were entirely separate organizations with no crossover whatsoever, not even frequent flyer miles or anything like that, and which is stupid, but that's the way it was. So you had people coming up to the lounge for one airline, so Virgin America, but they were flying on Virgin Australia, and they had to come in, please. You cannot. Well, I'm flying in first class, of course I can come in. This is the wrong lounge. But it says Virgin. Yeah, wrong Virgin. Come on. Really? So people would walk away and be just frustrated, and you can understand why. So these familiar brands don't always scale elegantly. It takes work. I'm going to zip through this because I don't have two teams left. But, like I said, I was part of the team that founded Virgin America, and for those of you that have flown within the U.S., you know it's crap. It's like beating yourself in the face. So we thought, right, if we put a little bit of money into it, we can beat that with this. That's the inside of the airplane. But to really do it properly, we had to imagine, I don't know how many of you own an Airbus, but that's what the empty one looks like. We had to imagine it was like that. And look at every way that a customer could interact with us and ensure that it had the same level of quality in everything that we did. So that no matter how somebody discovered us, we would still present the same, we would live up to the brand promise that was made by the sexy interior of the airplane. I'm going to end on this theme because I think it's really important. Now, in the olden days, there was online and there was offline. Online was the IT guys in the dungeon that you never went and spoke to, and offline was everything else. Those days are gone. The line has been blurred. The customer has set the expectation that if I start a conversation with you online, I should be able to walk into a branch or pick up the phone and continue that conversation. This sounds hard. It's not, and I'll show you what I mean. There is a subscription coffee company based in London called Pact. Every 2 weeks, in the mail, you get coffee beans. It's good stuff. We subscribed to it at a company I used to run in London, and we enjoyed it. But about 2 years ago, on a Saturday before Christmas, I was sitting at my grandmother's house in rural England, very hungover, not wanting to move anything except my thumb. So I was flicking through Twitter, and this sponsored tweet, meaning I did not follow them, came up. proper coffee, hand-roasted, blah, 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 blah. Now, I hate the word proper when used in a marketing context. It's lazy, it's self-aggrandizing, it's meaningless, it's snobbish. And I was so enraged, because I'm a little weird like that, that I called him out, said negative points for using that word. You're better than this. And I'm like, right, dumb man, the old man bit, and resumed my hangover, my fun away. Remember, 2 days, the Saturday before Christmas, and then there were three people at this entire company. Moments later, my phone says, holy crap, they replied. Sorry, we didn't mean to sound snobbish, just looking for a word that conveys good taste, maybe just tasty. Ha, love pack. And I am a firm believer, if you are genuinely believing the quality of what you are producing, you have every right to be confident. Confidence, just like confidence in a person, is incredibly attractive. So it's okay to do that. And I said basically that in my reply. You can legitimately refer to yourselves as great. And they replied saying, thank you very much. And I thought, wow, that's a great case study. Big companies don't do this. And this tiny company is getting it right the Saturday before Christmas. What a great case study. I'm going to share this. That wasn't the end of the story. Saturday, get to the office on Monday. There's a knock at the door. A courier gives us a huge box. Open it up, full of packed coffee, with a handwritten card that said, dear Alex, we hope you and your loved ones enjoy this over the festive period. Great coffee, sent fresh, love packed. So, they anonymously figured out who I was, where I worked, that I wasn't actually psychotic, and sent us this, and here's the most important thing. We were already a customer. It's not like they were trying to get us. So bravo to them. And so, to wrap up, you know, I often get asked this, and as I'm sure a lot of you do, what's next? What's the next shiny thing that we should be on? And as far as I'm concerned, you are great because of what you are currently doing. Just keep doing it. Don't chase the shiny. Be where your customers are, and you're going to be fine. Guys, thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it.